The Emergent Church, Reinventing the Way We Do Church. The term emergent simply means newly formed or prominent. Thus, the term for the popular thinking now shaping much of modern or postmodern Christianity. The emergent church, as defined, is not a denomination but represents a philosophy affecting all denominations. It doesn't have a formal structure or a formal leader, but it is seeking to rebuild church structure and infiltrate the hearts of all church leaders. Unfortunately, much of what the emergent church philosophy promotes goes against historic Christianity. In essence, it is postmodernism baptized and sanctified with the goal of reaching the masses with the gospel. It says, "We believe the way church has been done in the past is too old-fashioned, too tied to the Bible and to specific doctrines, and thus it's too exclusive of other people in their need to hear the gospel. So let's change our approach and style. We need to be more open and loving and less judgmental of those practices of which we don't approve. Let's mingle more with the people as Jesus did. While radical revolution, seeking to change the way we do church, and revamping religion for the 21st century may seem harmless and noble, the emergent church is built on a faulty, shifting foundation of anything goes. You're good. I'm good. We're all good. Let's mesh everything together. This gospel of self-building fires promoted by the emergent church is attracting millions because it has no boundaries. There are no more black and white do's and don'ts. It's all about love and acceptance. While more warmth and love is certainly needed within our walls, the problem is that everything has now turned gray. What God really thinks or says no longer matters. It becomes all about us. While integrating highly creative approaches in worship, music, and drama, and seeking to create a sensational sensory experience for worshipers, as well as to change preaching to dialogue and pull everyone into the group conversation, the tendency is to downplay the Bible and doctrines for the sake of seeking common ground and unity. Endless dialogue and questions with no concrete answers and the focus on subjective experiences above concrete scriptural truth is the mode of emergent church evangelism. Of course, this foundation is extremely dangerous for Bible-believing Protestant Christians such as ourselves. It is dangerous because this interfaith collaboration and focus leads to relativism, no absolute biblical truth or foundation, which we discussed earlier. Universalism, the belief that all human beings, regardless of their beliefs or lifestyles, will be saved. And syncretism, ultimate unity with all faiths, even those that appear contradictory. To many, the beauty of the whole philosophy is that with no absolutes and no objective truths, everyone can be right and no one needs to be offended. But is this the gospel that the Bible teaches? Is the purpose of the two-edged sword of God's word, Hebrews 4:12, rather than cutting and piercing our hearts and convicting us of sin, to be a warm, loving pat on the back? Two prominent leaders of the modern emergent church movement are Brian McLaren and Leonard Sweet, both of whom publicly promote Roman Catholic mysticism. Mysticism, in short, is the belief that direct knowledge of God, spiritual truth, and ultimate reality can be attained through subjective experiences and vague speculations. It all centers around the ability to tap into an inner knowing or inner voice for direction. As author John MacArthur writes, "The mystic disdains rational understanding and seeks truth instead through the feelings, the imagination, personal visions, inner voices, private illumination, or other purely subjective means." So what do these leading mystic worshippers of the emergent church movement actually think? On the cover of his best-selling book, A Generous Orthodoxy, Brian McLaren describes himself as a missional, evangelical, post-Protestant, liberal or conservative, mystical or poetic, biblical, charismatic or contemplative, fundamentalist or Calvinist, Anabaptist or Anglican, Methodist, Catholic, Green, incarnational, depressed yet hopeful, emergent, unfinished Christian. As to be expected, McLaren's book is a smorgasbord of ideas proclaimed in the name of Christ. McLaren shares that he has grown tired of the Christian church of today. He wants to deconstruct the old and reconstruct a new kind of Christian faith. And his ultimate goal is for radical theological reformation, or a new framework for theology. However, many of his ideas are actually forbidden or rejected by Scripture. As one author writes, not only are they, McLaren's ideas, not found in the Bible, but they won't work with an intact Bible. In order for the emerging church to succeed, the Bible must be looked at through entirely different glasses, and Christianity needs to be open to a new type of faith. Leonard Sweet's views are equally disconcerting. In his book, Quantum Spirituality, Sweet positively quotes Jesuit philosopher Karl Rahner, stating, "The Christian of tomorrow will be a mystic, one who has experienced something, or he will be nothing." While pulling people together from all Christian faiths, Sweet minimizes the importance of the blood of Christ, teaching that all spiritual roads, even those outside of Christ, are equally valid and lead to God. Sounds like another twist on all roads lead to Rome. But that's not what the Bible teaches. Neither is there salvation in any other, speaking of Christ. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Acts 4:12. Dan Kimball, pastor of the Vintage Faith Church in Santa Cruz, California, and another well-known leader in the emergent church movement, wrote the book, The Emerging Church, Vintage Christianity for New Generations. Kimball's ideas may not seem so dangerous at first glance, but let's look at what Kimball has to say as he considers the world and Christianity of today. In a post-Christian world, pluralism is the norm. Buddhism, Wicca, Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, or an eclectic, that is, a choice made from many different options, blend. It's all part of the soil. He further claims that the basis for learning has shifted from logic and the rational to the realm of experience and the mystical, stressing the importance of the multi-sensory experience in worship, candles, incense, props, etc., and explaining why it's important to turn the lights down. Kimball explains, in the emerging culture, darkness represents spirituality. He goes on, we see this in Buddhist temples as well as Catholic and Orthodox churches. Darkness communicates something seriousness is happening. Something serious is happening, but it's not something good. It is important to understand here that Satan is not simply trying to draw people to the dark side of a good versus evil conflict. He's trying to eradicate the gap between himself and God and between good and evil altogether and make darkness appear as light. Howard Peth, in his book, The Dangers of Contemplative Prayer, sums it up this way. The emerging church has sold out Christianity by using high-tech marketing methods to create their seeker-friendly congregations with a watered-down gospel, one that de-emphasizes sin and repentance and promotes sensual approaches to a counterfeit worship. But in reality, the only thing they have to peddle is Satan's same old poison packaged in new bottles. Is this the way we really want to do church? In summary, there are four things that should especially concern us with the emergent church movement. Consider how one Adventist pastor has summed up these dangers. First, the emergent church movement either minimizes or ignores the life and death importance of believing in, humbly submitting to, and fully obeying solid, non-negotiable Bible truth, especially the three angels' messages. Secondly, even though Christian concepts may be strongly expressed, much of EC teaching is insidiously laced with Roman Catholic mysticism and New Ageism, both of which ultimately lead to the greatest peril of all, deadly spiritualism and invasion by evil spirits. Third, under the guise of promoting a deeper experience with God, EC teachings have become one of Satan's subtlest vehicles in his campaign to deceive, if possible, even the elect. Matthew 24:24. Fourth, my biggest concern is for Seventh-day Adventists, especially our young people. At all costs, we must avoid these dangers. Pause. What are we thinking? Although times and cultures may change, God's word does not change. His truth never changes. It never alters from generation to generation. The emergent church is proffering the idea today that truth is relative and alters just like evolution. And so therefore, the truth of the Bible needs to be adapted to fit our culture as we perceive it. That is blasphemy. This is not how truth works. It is not how it has ever worked. Our generation is not a special generation that can take the Word of God and diminish it down to the level of the culture. The level of the culture is supposed to be convicted and brought up again to the convicting truth of the Word of God. We are in continual danger of getting above the simplicity of the gospel. Ellen White writes, "We are in continual danger of getting above the simplicity of the gospel," Ellen White writes. She continues, "There is an intense desire on the part of many to startle the world with something original that shall lift the people into a state of spiritual ecstasy and change the present order of experience. There is certainly great need of a change in the present order of experience, for the sacredness of present truth is not realized as it should be. But the change we need is a change of heart, and can only be obtained by seeking God individually for His blessing, by pleading with Him for His power, by fervently praying that His grace may come upon us and that our characters may be transformed. This is the change we need today. And for the attainment of this experience, we should exercise persevering energy and manifest heartfelt earnestness. For far too long, Adventists have been experts on biblical theology and doctrine without having that personal, intimate, day-by-day walk with Christ. We need heart change. We need a deeper heart experience that is authentic and real, not merely a pretense to protect our respectability. The heart change we need will come by digging deeper in God's Word and by greater heartfelt surrender to His desires and commands. Inspiration tells us God's workers must gain a far deeper experience. If they will surrender all to Him, He will work mightily for them. When God's servants with consecrated zeal cooperate with divine instrumentalities, the state of things that exists in this world will be changed, and soon the earth will with joy receive her King. Then they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. Daniel 12, verse 3. In the 1960s, they used to say, "If it feels good, do it." Today, the popular message is, "If it feels good, it must be right." Everywhere we turn, we hear, "Follow your heart, do what feels right to you." However, God's word tells us, "He that trusteth in his own heart is a fool." Proverbs 28, 26. When we allow our heart and emotions to lead us, we become subservient to our feelings over the facts of God's word. Rather than cultivating a spirit of surrender, we are encouraged to foster a spirit of selfishness. Is this the path to follow if we are to be ready to meet Jesus? I think the answer is obvious, at least if we study our Bibles. As we move forward, seeking to avoid the dangers of the postmodern emergent church movement, and as we seek to recognize the different forms of counterfeit revival sweeping Christianity today, let us dare to ask for more, Not more warm, fuzzy feelings and sensations. Not more endless dialogue with no answered questions, but more wisdom to discern the truth and stand upon God's word. Only as we stand on the truths of Scripture will we be transformed, and true transformation comes only by the infilling of the Holy Spirit.